Good morning, Grace. Are you guys ready to worship this morning? Yeah. Let's all worship together.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, you only. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You gave hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour our praise to you only. And all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing, great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing, great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will say, great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, you only. And great are you, Lord.
Amazing love that welcomes me, the kind
kindness of mercy. Then bow with blood, orderly, my soul undeserving. God, your soul care. God, your soul care. Oh God.
Good morning. Your scripture reading today is in 1
Corinthians 10, 6 through 12, and then we're going to jump to verse 31 as well. So verse 6 says, "Now these things took place as examples for us, that we might not desire evil as they did. Do not be idolaters, as some of them were, as it was written. The people sat down to eat and to drink and rose up to play. We must not indulge in sexual immorality, as some of them did, and 23,000 fell in a single day. We must not put Christ to the test, as some of them did and were destroyed by serpents, nor grumble as some of them did and were destroyed by the destroyer. Now these things happened to them as an example, but they were written down for our instruction, on whom the end of the ages has come. Therefore, let anyone who thinks that he stands take heed lest he fall." And then we're going to jump down to 31. "So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God." That's it. All right. Now I'm going to introduce our speaker, Tim Rumley, and I'm going to pray for him, and then we'll give the floor to him. All right, let's bow our heads and pray. Dear Lord, I'm so thankful that we can come together on a Tuesday morning and hear your word. I just ask that you give Tim the words to speak and the things to say, God, and that we would all gather something from this today and go out and live it in our day today, Lord. It's in your name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Yeah, hey, I was wondering if that was coming. So I was going to stand here awkwardly with all these papers in my hand if I didn't. Thanks, Cody. Last week, I was minding my own business in Orlando, Florida, at the annual meeting of the Association for Biblical Higher Education, just going about my business, learning about things to help me do my job here, and all of a sudden, Rick Polisi is standing in front of me, saying, "Hey, would you like to speak at chapel on Tuesday?" Not part of my plan, not what I was intending for this morning. And because of that, I know God sent me here today. And God sent me here with a message for you. And because I know that, I have something to say to you. Jim Gamble and I were talking about this just before chapel. In the name of Jesus, creator of heaven and earth, your Redeemer who died on the cross and rose again, who will one day rule the nations with a rod of iron, the one to whom all glory belongs, put your phone away. If you couldn't hear that, she said, "I'm sending your wife a picture." I mean, put your phone away or turn off anything other than the scripture. Some people say they take notes on it. My thumbs are way too fat for that. But if you can handle that. But anything other than what's going on right here, I want you to know something. Every message you've ever been in, every church service, it's not just the preacher's job. What we're in here right now is a collective effort, and you're as much a part of it as I am. And if your actions distract you or distract someone else from what God has to say here, you are performing a spiritual abortion. Don't do it. Today or ever. All right, now that you're mad at me, please pray for me and let me lead us as we pray together. Heavenly Father, you sent me here to talk about temptation today. Please empower me by your Holy Spirit to do so in a way that puts Christ at the center and honors him to whom alone belongs glory forever and ever. And by your Holy Spirit, speak to the heart of every person here today. And because we've been here, may we all not succumb to temptation. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. So I was studying to be a preacher at another school, and you know, the Christian service, we called it their practical Christian work. We had a whole office that instead of us finding it, they assigned us to places. And so along about my third semester, they assigned me to the Carmen Manor Nursing Home on a near north side of Chicago. I looked it up online last night. It still exists, still there, still looks just like it did. And they sent me there on Sundays to preach a service. We went into, on the top floor, they had a day room that had glass all around. It was very, very sunny, and they would bring us in, and they set up a little area for a church service. And there were, some of the residents would come and take seats at the front. You could tell they were regular churchgoers. They were looking forward to church on Sunday. Others shuffled in, nothing better to do, and then some at the back were wheeled in by nurses in or nursing aides in their wheelchairs and lined up around the back, and many of them didn't seem to even be able to pay attention to what was going on. But the first Sunday I preached there, I got up. I don't know what I was preaching. I don't remember anything I said. I certainly didn't tell them to put their cell phones away. But I started to speak, and suddenly one of those ladies in a wheelchair in the back row said, "We know that. Tell us something we don't know." Okay, fine. I pause, find my place in my notes, and start over again. I get a few more sentences in, and all of a sudden, "We know that. Tell us something we don't know." And I kid you not, every 2 to 3 minutes for the whole sermon, "We know that. Tell us something we don't know." Well, as I was having that conversation with Rick Polisi, he said, the passage is 1 Corinthians 10. And I said, "Oh, great. I love 1 Corinthians 10:31. Whether therefore you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God." And he says, "Well, I think we were going to focus on verse 13, and the topic is temptation." And I said, "Okay." And I thought about it for a minute. I thought, wow, talk about a topic that's, "We know that, tell us something we don't know." I mean, what does the verse say? "No temptation has taken you, but such as is common to man." That's the first thing I want you to hear from this passage this morning. Temptation is normal. Temptation is normal. Common as dirt. There's nothing, or very few things, more common. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Therefore, all of us are subject to temptation. All of us face the challenge of whether I'm going to do God's will or do my own will or do what the world's pushing me to do or do what the devil is seducing me to do. There's nothing more normal than temptation. You and I, every one of us, spend our days immersed in it. Temptation is normal. And in fact, I don't know if you picked up on it as we started our scripture reading in the middle of the passage, that the Apostle Paul started this passage with a review of your Old Testament literature class. Did you all pick up on that? Did you hear it say, "Oh, wow, my favorite class. I'm glad they went back there to that one." They went back to the story of the book of Exodus, Israel in the wilderness. And, you know, from Paul's vantage point, that was like somewhere 1,100, 1,300 years before he lived. Now it's 3,300 years before we lived. And he lists five temptations that those people of Israel succumbed to. How common is temptation? You could, 2,000 years ago, make a list from 1,000 years before, and here today, we still got that list. Now, these things took place as examples for us. These things. Israel had been delivered from Egypt, and God parted the Red Sea, drowned the Egyptian army, gave them water where there was no water, food where there was no food, a light to light the way at night, a cloud to lead the way in the daytime, took them out, gave them freedom. And he says that we might not desire evil as they did. They were tempted and they fell to coveting, to greed, to lust. Because coveting is normal. In their case, it was just, or not just, but it was that they said, oh, we should have stayed in Egypt where we had lots of food. Everything's scary out here in the desert. And they started wanting what God didn't have for them. Being greedy, desirous. We all know that. Okay, I read a book while I was traveling last week. I recommend it to you, a secular book, nothing Christian about it at all. It was called The Psychology of Money. It's just 80 pages, 20 really short chapters. Great little book. But the author says when he was in college, he worked as a valet parking cars in Hollywood. And he said, if you want to drive really cool cars, work as a valet in Hollywood. He parked Ferraris, Lamborghinis, Porsches, whatever the case may be. And he makes several points for that, but one of them that really stood out to me, I mean, I like cars. Cars are like one of the things I've always found cool. Maybe some of you do, some of you don't. I don't know, but I like cars. But he said, you know, everybody in Hollywood has to drive a cool car so they can be seen. So, but I found out something is I would take those cars and go around the block and park them. If you're driving a Ferrari, the one thing nobody sees is you. They see the car and you vanish. So movie stars drive down the street in Hollywood all the time. No one sees the movie star, they see the car. And isn't that true about almost any bling we could get? We vanish, people see the bling. So coveting is normal, doesn't get us anywhere. That's not a spiritual application, but it can distract us from everything God has for us. I mean, coveting for a college student, I mean, why are you in college? Well, man, I want a great career. I want to make good money. I either want money or I want to be famous or I want to be powerful. And this is a good way to get there. Be careful what you want. Coveting is normal. Idolatry. Do not be idolaters, as some of them. Now, coveting then leads to idolatry. Idolatry is just expecting any created thing to do for you what only God can do. Expecting any created thing to do for you what only God can do. A Ferrari can't do for you what God can do. A boyfriend, a girlfriend, a husband, a wife can't do for you what only God can do. Having children, I have 6 of them, 11 grandchildren. I think having children is great, but I have seen couples idolatrize, is that a word? Their children, expecting children to do for them what only God can do. A job can't do for you what only God can do. Clothes can't. Satisfaction, well-being, security in life, they can't do it. The author of that book, Psychology of Money, said there's only one enduring thing money can buy. Now, this isn't a spiritual, this isn't a Christian application, but it's interesting. A secularist looked at it and said the only thing money can buy that really matters or makes people satisfied is the ability to decide how you're going to spend your time. He said every physical object you buy with it is empty as soon as you have it. Its whole value is in wanting it. Coveting and idolatry, very similar to each other. Common as dirt. Sexual immorality. I noticed my brother, as we read the scripture, dropped the mic down as he said those words. Really, sexual immorality? Talk about tell me something you don't know. Now, come on. I like to read blogs from Psychology Today. A lot of them are not Christian at all, even anti-Christian, but I learn a lot from them. And there's in my Google News feed, speaking of the phone, they keep bringing up one over and over again. Makes me mad. I think they know that. I actually haven't even read it, but the headline is, why are religious people so obsessed with sex? And I look at that. What? Did we make all those TV shows? Did we make all those movies? Do we own all the porn sites? Are we the ones putting out the songs with the nasty lyrics? Why are religious people so obsessed? People are obsessed with sex. And you're living with that in a way that no other generation before you ever has. I had a really depressing few minutes last night on the internet, not looking at porn. But I had to be careful how I phrased my Google search. I wanted the latest statistics. I had the latest statistics. And here's where I'm going with this. I had to look for the latest statistics on porn usage among your age group. I had heard all sorts of things, and there's all sorts of problems with the methodology. No one really knows what the number is. I had repeatedly heard something like 3/4 of guys, 1/3 of girls used porn intentionally in the last month. The highest number I saw for your age group, 18 to 24, 18 to 25 last night, was 98% of guys and 60% of gals. I didn't see anything as low as 3/4 and 1/3. And I don't know what's going on in your life, but my point is temptation is normal, and it is more normal in terms of pornography for you than it has been for any other generation. And by the way, there's two temptations that I'm trying to avoid as I talk about these normalcies. One, I don't want to spend a whole lot of time convincing you there's something wrong with these. We had a speaker speak on porn a few years ago, and I followed two guys back over to the Jacks. I was going to my office. They didn't know I was behind them. Couldn't hear it. They were discussing how there's nothing wrong with porn. I'm not going to try and convince you today. If that's how you feel, go talk to Jesus about it. Because I know that's not what he thinks. And he has to convince you. There's nothing I can do. That is not one man with one woman in a marriage covenant entering into God's act of creation. Sexual immorality, you are facing it, and you know, college students have always faced, are they going to reserve sex for marriage? And you're up against that. You have to make that decision every date, every day. Nothing more common. So we must not indulge in sexual immorality. It was happening 3,300 years ago, and it's, if the Lord tarries, it'll be happening 3,300 years from now. We must not put Christ to the test, as some of them did, and were destroyed by serpents. Now, this is common as dirt among Christians, especially, but also among unbelievers, and it may not sound like it, but was it put Christ to the test? That simply means I'll love and trust God if he makes everything the way I want it to be. In the story of Israel, they had headed for the promised land. They got partway there. They were ready to go in. They sent in some spies. The spies came back and said, the land is great, but the enemies are too big. We can't take it. And God said, all right, fine. You can all die in the wilderness and your kids will go in. And what do? The next day they say, oh, we didn't mean it. We're going to go ahead and go. And they got their butts kicked. They said, look, God, we'll serve you if you do things the way we say. And that's a huge temptation. Is Christianity just a way for me to get benefits? And then the last one listed, nor grumble as some of them did. Now, I know college students never complain. College students never complain about the food. Again, when I was a student at that other institution, there was a national survey of food service at various institutions, and the food service there at the institution I was attending put these posters up that showed that in some national group survey, whatever, some state school, I've forgotten which one, was ranked as the number one food in the nation. Number two was the little tiny Christian school I was going to. And number three was Ohio State University. I remember that one. Ohio State was number three. You know what everyone in the student body said? I'm sure glad I don't eat at Ohio State. couldn't look at it and say, man, we got the second best food in the country. No, if we're second, I don't want to eat at third. There's always something to complain about. You know the phrase first world problems? Here was my first world problem this week. On Tuesday, last Tuesday, a week ago today, I got on an airplane and flew to Orlando. Spent 4 days in a wonderful resort, way better than I can afford because Grace Christian University is paying for me. Man, that was nice. They treat you like royalty there. It was fantastic. 4 days. And I learned a bunch that I have to use in my job to help Grace Christian University succeed for you. And Saturday morning, I got up early. I drove to the airport, got on an airplane, and flew back to Grand Rapids. And we've landed, and we're taxiing, and the pilot comes on and says, we're going to have you in the gate about 15 minutes early. Life is wonderful. I'm praising God. Nothing to complain about here. And then the airplane stopped. And out the window on my left, you can see the terminal. You can see airplanes in the gates. You can see lots of gates. And we sit there. And all of a sudden, the pilot comes on and he says, well, I just want to keep you in the loop about what's happening here. There's some problem with the plane that's in the gate before us. I'm sure they'll get that resolved. We'll be in a few minutes. And we sit there. And the pilot comes on and says, oh, there's an airplane behind us. We're not moving to the gate yet, but I've got to get out of their way. So we do a lap around the airport. We come back and we sit there. And he comes back out and he says, you can see the airplane is backed out just a little bit from the gate. It's like 100 feet from the gate. He says, their engines won't start. Now, then I start to think, man, if I'm on that plane, I'm getting off and I'm not getting back on. You know, here comes the guy with a pickup truck and jumper cables. And another plane comes behind us. We do the lap around the airport again, and they finally switch gates, and we can see all these open gates while we're waiting for this one blocked one. And finally, an hour later, we pull into the gate. And I'm texting my wife, who's picking me up, and I'm complaining. When I'm part of a tiny one fraction of 1% of people who ever lived in the world who could fly to a warm place in the middle of winter, spend 4 days in a resort being catered to, and be delayed a whole hour on a Saturday morning. Common as dirt, complaining is normal. Coveting is normal, idolatry is normal, sexual immorality is normal, testing God is normal, complaining is normal. I said, I don't want to convince you these are wrong. I also don't want to spend a whole lot of time on how bad they are. If you look at the text, it says that 23,000 fell in a single day. Some of them were destroyed as serpents. Others were destroyed by the destroyer. What happened is none of them got to what God had for them. None of them got to God's goals for them because they chose temptation instead. So I got to pick up the pace here. You praying for me? I have trouble preaching this short. So pray for me, all right? Temptation is normal, but listen to this. Walk away with this one. Normal is not a synonym for right. People do that all the time. Oh, that's just normal. Everybody does it. Listen, folks, in a world where God tells us all has sinned and come short of the glory of God, everybody does it is not an argument in favor of anything. If anything, it should make you really suspicious about it. So let me just quickly give you three implications of normal is not a synonym for right. Therefore, let anyone who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. Be alert. America needs more alerts. Oh, come on. All right, never mind. Brian got it. Be alert. Don't be normal, be alert. Be aware of what's going on around you. There are traps everywhere to keep you from accomplishing what God has you to accomplish, from being what God wants you to be, from having all the joy, peace, and satisfaction and glorifying Christ the way God wants you to glorify him. Be alert. You can't just drift through life. Be intentional about every day. Life is what you're living right now. Sometimes school feels like this is practice and we'll get to the game, you know, after graduation. No, this is the real thing. You're in it right now. Be alert. Be aware. Be grabbing what God has for you today. Because no temptation is taking you, but such as is common to man. Number two, be exceptional. Be exceptional. Don't be common, everyday, ordinary. God wants you to be exceptional. We'll talk about that a little more in just a moment. And then be dependent on God. Now, we can hear that. No temptation is taking you, but such as is common to man. It's very easy to say, oh, everybody faces this. I got it. No big deal. But look at the scripture. I hope you're looking at that. No temptation has taken you that is not common to man. God is faithful. Hear this clearly from me. If you look at it and say, well, everybody faces this, it must be no big deal. I got this. You're roadkill. You're roadkill for the devil. You're roadkill for the world. You're roadkill for your own flesh. You must have the power of the resurrection of Christ working in you if you want to leave that temptation behind and be exceptional. So how are we going to be exceptional? Well, let me tell you, God's grace is exceptional. Grace is exceptional. And for the rest of the chapter, Paul turns the focus away from the dangers, the pitfalls, the nastiness of temptation and sin toward what God can do and how God you can participate in God doing it. You have got to have the work of the grace of Christ. How do you do that? Well, verse 14, he says, therefore, my beloved, flee from idolatry. And then in 21, you cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake in the table of the Lord and the table of demons. Grace is living out the resurrection life by hanging out with God. Living the Christian life is hanging out with God. Everywhere you are, everything you're doing. If you're in chapel, I encourage you to pray for me. Pray with me. Be part of this. That's hanging out with God. You're heading to a class. Don't go to that class just with your classmates. You go with the Holy Spirit. This is your act of worship to God, to hang on every word that professor is saying, to participate, to ask questions, to help others along, because it's God's class. It's not just yours. When you go to the library to study, you're studying with God, and you're doing everything you're doing for his glory. When you go out to have fun, guess what? God's fine with that, but you take him with you. That's why I said if you want to argue about whether pornography is wrong, go talk to him about it. You can do whatever you can take him with you in. You have got, if you aren't going to be roadkill, if you aren't going to be common as dirt, if you aren't going to be the ordinary one, you've got to hang out with God and everything, and you can't hang out with God and demons at the same time. Cannot be done. Next paragraph, in verse 24, he says, let no one seek his own good, but the good of his neighbor. Grace is living to benefit others. Someone asked Jesus, what's the greatest commandment? He said, well, the greatest commandment is love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. That's hanging out with God. The second one is like to it, love your neighbor as yourself. That's this paragraph. Don't get all wrapped up in, oh, no, terrible things are going to happen to me if I fall to temptation. Or, oh, no, I won't have what I want if I don't fall to temptation. Get out of yourself and live for the glory of God and the good of others. Got a bunch of staff members over here, a few everywhere else. Look around this room. This is the these are the others we're living for, folks. You want enthusiasm in your job? Turn around and look at these people. These are who we're serving. Live for the benefit of others. Back to the sexual immorality. If you will live for the benefit of your boyfriend or your girlfriend, then you're going to let sexual activity wait for marriage because that's the best thing for them. May not be what you feel like, but it's the best thing for them. Live for the benefit of others. Get out of yourself. Live in the presence of God and for the benefit of others. And be exceptional. Grace is shining with God's glory in every detail of your life. I love this verse. And I couldn't stay at temptation. I had to get to it. I sat down that night at Frick Tucker and said, how do I get from verse 13 to verse 31? How did Paul get there? So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Glory! What's glory? It's shining. It's the brightness of the sun. It's the stars twinkling in the heaven. It's the moon shining at night. Moses, after he hung out with God, so shone with God's glory, they had to put a cloth over his face. I couldn't look at him. That can be you. Shining for God's glory on the athletic court. Shining for God's glory in the classroom. Shining for God's glory with your friendships, in your job, whatever you're doing, in every detail. And that's why I don't want to spend a whole lot of time. What's wrong with that sin? If you spend your time saying, oh no, I've got to resist. I'm going to be so stained if I get involved in sin. You're going to give in. You are. It doesn't work. This is what I want you looking at. I can live for God's glory in my dating life. I can shine like the sun in my marriage. My job can be being a courageous ambassador for Christ at Steelcase or Gordon Foods. I can shine for God's glory, and that is what will leave temptation behind. Stand with me. Some of you studying for the ministry, I'm about to do something that if you're going to be a preacher, I want you to learn to do this. Never say at the end of a service, you are dismissed. Send people out with God's blessing. Learn to pronounce a benediction. And there is a benediction I love at the end of the book of Jude. Pray with me. Now, to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless, exceptional, before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, now and forever. Amen.